Thank you so much for joining us today. God has a plan and purpose for your life, and we hope today's message will inspire you to discover all that He intends for your life. Be sure to send us your story, as we'd love to hear how God is working in your life. If you'd like to partner with this ministry financially, you can do that by going to jubileecalgary.com/give and pick the giving option that is most convenient for you. We hope you enjoy today's message.
We've been doing our shift series, and of course, shift is to cause someone or something to move or to change from one position or direction to another, especially slightly. And I want to finish off and close off this series today by encouraging you to never give up. Sometimes it's easy to quit. How many of you guys have ever faced a situation where it's just been right in your face and it's just shouting in your face, just give up? Why don't you give up? Anybody here? Yeah. I've got this video for you I'd like you to watch. Never give up. I'm tired just watching that video. I sit there and I lose my breath because he's, you know, I hate running. So, but what a powerful image of somebody who came from behind and never gave up. Anywhere along that race, he could have said, you know what, I'm done. I'm too far behind. And you know, sometimes in life, we have the same issue where we feel like we're just too far behind, that we can't catch up. Maybe we feel like in our situation, there's no way of coming out of this situation in first. But God says never give up. And the reason why we often quit is because we don't believe we can win. We often quit because we don't believe we can win. But how many of you know here today that through Jesus Christ, we're all winners? That He has been made us more than conquerors through Jesus Christ who loved us. And the reason why you win isn't because of your effort, it's because of the fact that Christ loves you. That the love of God for you is so unconditional and so real that it is the very thing that carries you to your victory. And we have to believe that we can win. We have to believe that in the situation that we're facing, in all the disappointments that we're seeing, in all of the things that our past is telling us, you can't move forward because of this, this, and this. We have to say, no, I'm a winner, and I will finish my race in first. I am a winner. How many of you know that you're winners here today? How many of you sometimes don't feel like you're winning? You're still a winner. Through Jesus Christ who loved you, you are a winner. And we have to know that we can win. We have to believe, we have to have a mindset that we can do what God has called us to do. Maybe it's the struggle with addictions. Maybe it's a struggle with relationships. Maybe it's a struggle with different thoughts. And maybe it's financial stuff. We have to believe that we can win in those things. We have to know that our God is there for us, that He's working in us and through us to bring about the very best possible result in every situation in our life. But you've got to believe that you can win. You've got to believe that God wants you to win. Even though you feel far behind, maybe you got a slow start, maybe you've made some decisions in life where you feel like everybody is so much more ahead of me in their walk with God. It doesn't matter. You know, all it takes is a few days of transformation in the presence of God, and you will feel like you're right on par with where God wants you to be. It's amazing what God can do inside of us if we will let Him give us that mentality and that faith that we are winners in Him. It doesn't matter if people have given up on you. People might have given up on you. They might have said, you know what, you'll never be a winner. You'll never win like you feel like you should. But it doesn't matter. When people give up on you, God has not given up on you. God is there and He is supporting you and He is cheering you on. He's the crowd in that stand that is saying, you can do this. But He's also the wind behind your back. He's the strength in your legs. He's the power in your heart. He's the breath in your lungs that will carry you across the line in first place. This is the God that we serve. We have to change our focus from where we're losing and say, that is not who I am. God, give me your wisdom to win. And we have to believe that we can. In Luke 21:19, Jesus said this. He said, stand firm and you will win life. Stand firm and you will win life. So the question that we ask ourselves is, how am I standing right now? What am I doing to stand? Have I quit? Am I sit? You know, some of us are walking through life and we are just surviving. We think, you know, if I can make it to glory at the end of my life, I'm happy enough. But the glory of God was meant to be seen on this earth through you, through your life, through what you are and who you are. And you've got to say, there is more to my life than just dying and seeing God at the end of my days. That I carry a grace in my life, that you carry a grace in your life to change the world. That you have to take the lid off of your thinking and say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and that means winning the race that I'm running. I might have had a slow start, but watch me, I'm going to have the first place finish. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? We've got to believe that. This is how God has made us more than conquerors. This is the mindset that He's given us. In your families, whatever you're facing, the struggles, God says, you can overcome the situation that you're facing, but you cannot give up. You cannot quit. You can't take the condemnation for the failures. You have to get back up and you have to run again. You can't walk through life just wanting to survive. You've got to run and push for the victory every day. You have to have that expectation, expectancy that you can cross that line in first place. In Mark 9:23, there's a father who comes to Jesus. And his son was having seizures. And the father goes to Jesus and says, Jesus, my son, the spirit, it overtakes him and tries to throw him into the fire and tries to kill him. You know you have an enemy that's trying to kill you? You have an enemy that's trying to destroy the very kingdom of God in your life? Every single one of you carries a seed of the kingdom of God. Every single one of you has the capacity to reveal the kingdom of God on this earth. And if the enemy can get you to quit, but this man comes to Jesus and says, if you can heal him, would you please heal him? And Jesus kind of repeats, he says, if I can? But it's interesting because Jesus takes the conversation and he switches it back to the Father. And he goes, nothing is impossible to those who believe. And Jesus says, truth is, I can, but it's not about that. It's whether you're going to quit and stop believing. It's about whether or not you're going to believe that I can do this. And he takes it and he puts it on the Father and he says, if you will believe, nothing is impossible. If you will believe, nothing is impossible. We have to get the impossibilities out of our mind and start believing God for the possible. We have to get into the Word of God and find the promises and hear His voice so that we know where He's leading us and what He's promising for us to take a hold of. We have no business pursuing things that God has not promised. But when we know what God has promised, I tell you what, you don't quit. And you're going to have an enemy that's going to try and stop. And there's two ways the enemy works. Number one, he gets you to think in a way that is negative, so then by your own thought life, you make your own decisions that throw you off the course. Or number two, he sees that you're still on course and believing, and he throws everything he can to get you off track. So number one, you've got to make sure that your actions and your belief are not going to line up with the lies of the enemy. And when you've got to that point, you make sure that you're standing strong, because the enemy's going to try and throw you off course. He's going to try and tell you that you're not going to make it, that you can't heal the sick, that you can't lay your hands on the blind and see them healed, that you can't lay your hands on the deaf ears and see them. That's what the enemy wants to tell you. Every single one of us has this capacity to live like Jesus did. Every single one. And if the enemy can get us to quit and to give up somewhere along the path, we'll never see Jesus in the fullness that he has intended to live in our life. I want my life to be an image of who Jesus is. And if I quit and I give up because of my slow start, because of my past, because somebody gave up on me, the world's not going to see Jesus the way they need to see Jesus. And every single one of us has that capacity. Nothing is impossible to those who believe. When you quit on you, you quit on God. I'll say that again. When you quit on you, you quit on God. Who did God choose to allow his Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit to dwell in to show the glory of God? Who did he pick? You better raise your hands, everybody. You better raise your hand, because if you're not raising your hand, I'm going to come slap you upside the head. It's time for us as Christians to know that we've been chosen by God, and when we quit on ourselves because of our disappointments and our failures, we are quitting on God. And God picked us because he believes we can do this. Because he believes we're winners. He believes that we can cross the line in first place because we're his children. We have to shift our identity and know who we are in Christ. There's three things that bring transformation in life. Number one is the truth and living the truth. Number two, living in community and getting all the crap out of the closet. If we're living life with secrets, it's going to keep us from living and walking free of all that God has for us. And the third thing is that anointed word of God in our life that comes from being in the presence of God. If we're not in the presence of God on a regular basis, our mindset will shift back to that loser mentality. That's why the word of God is so important. It's not an obligation. Oh, it's my religious ritual to read my Bible. No, in the word of God is life, and it shows me that I'm a winner. And it shows me how to win. That's why the word of God is so important. But when you quit on you, you quit on God. So stop quitting on yourself. Look at yourself and say, I am who God has made me to be. I will live what God has created me to live. I will overcome my addictions. I will overcome my relationship problems. I will push through the inadequacies. I will stop doubting that God can use me. I will lay hands on the sick and see them recover. I will walk the fullness of Jesus in this earth. I will, and nobody's going to stop me, because it's definitely not going to be me, and that's the only person that decides whether or not you're going to walk in the fullness of God. You are the only person that will decide how far you go in God. You are the one that's responsible for your own growth. It's not your pastor. It's not your church. At the end of the day, you're responsible for your own growth in Christ. And you say, I can do this. You can do this. I believe in you. God believes in you. Don't quit on you. When we don't allow the process, we give up our victory. Now, there's part of this which is a process. There's part of this changing and conforming of the world that we have to get rid of and transform our minds according to the word of God. There are steps sometimes to our healing. Some of you have been believing God for a long time for your healing. Don't quit and don't give up. There's something in this season of life that you can take from this that will make you stronger and better in your next season of life. There's something past this season of your life, of this struggle, that when you get past it, you're going to be able to bring redemption and freedom to somebody else who's going through the same thing. You can take your struggle and turn it into growth and become a winner. It makes you stronger. You go to the gym, what do? You add more weight. And sometimes you can't lift it all, but hey, if a half rep builds that muscle, eventually it turns into a full rep. So you're going from just pushing maybe 450, right? Come on. Come on now. Yeah. 450, you know, to a full 450, right? And then you like throw on a couple more hundred, right? Come on, bring it on, right? But it's that push through and that struggle, and maybe you can't get it all the way where it needs to go, but you're not quitting, and you keep pushing, and you let it grow you, and you grow in your heart, and you grow in your faith, and you grow in your love, and then it becomes real to you. And then when it becomes real to you, that's where the authority and the power in your life comes from. When you've experienced transformation in your life, that's when you can bring transformation to other people's lives. Otherwise, this is all just a bunch of information. Otherwise, this is just a bunch of, yeah, I know this verse, I know that verse, I know la-ti-da. Transformation comes from experience. The power of transformation in other people's lives comes from you being able to share your transformation and impart that into them. And if the world needs to change, then we need to change. And we can do it because why? We're winners. And we come in first place because we're not giving up on God. We're not giving up on us. There's a story about Naaman the leper. Naaman was second to the king in Syria. He was a commander, very respected, very powerful. He had a lot of conquests. But there's one thing about Naaman that he had that isolated him from everybody else, and that was leprosy. And it's ironic, he had a servant girl. So in other words, they had conquest and they had beaten another nation, and they took this servant girl who would serve his wife, and the servant girl said, hey, there's this guy Elijah. And this guy Elijah, he'll pray for you and you'll be healed. So what does Naaman do? Naaman goes to the king of Syria and says, hey, is it okay if I go to Israel? There's this guy there who can pray for me and I can get healed. He goes and gets to Elijah's house thinking, I'm going to get this guy. He's going to come out. He's going to heal me. It's going to be wonderful. This process is going to be ABC. It's going to just happen this way. He's got this picture in his mind of how this is all going to happen. And he gets there and he knocks on the door, and the messenger, Elijah's messenger, opens the door, says, yes, can I help you? And Naaman's thinking, hey, I'm Naaman, I'm the commander of Syria. I'm here to get healed. Is Elijah here? And messenger says, just a second. Messenger goes in, gets Elijah, says, Elijah, there's this guy outside, Naaman, he's a leper from Syria. He was told to come here, you'd heal him. What does Elijah do? Just go back to him, tell him to go to the River Jordan and dip 7 times. Well, Naaman's like, what? I tell you what, if you're a pastor and you do that, you lose your job. That's a quick way to offend people as a pastor. Tell somebody else to tell them just to do this. Well, I wanted to talk to the pastor. Okay, well, that's okay. I like talking to you guys, so we're... But... And so Naaman gets ripped off. First of all, he's like, who? Does he know who I am? I'm second to the king in Syria, and I'm here to get healed. And so he gets upset. He gets angry. Not only that, he's like, why the River Jordan? There's other rivers that are a whole lot cleaner and more beautiful than the river. I mean, River Jordan's like a little mud pit pretty much, right? It's murky and filthy. And why would I want to go baptize myself 7 times in a filthy river? And it's interesting because Naaman almost walked away from his victory that day because of the fact that he thought the process was supposed to be a certain way. But somebody convinces Naaman to go to the river. Naaman dips 7 times. Well, the first time he goes down, he comes up, there's no change. I don't know if you're thinking like me, which that's dangerous. I'm thinking, okay, after first time up, I should see a little bit of a change. Second time down, second time up, should be getting a little bit better every time, right? It wasn't until the 7th time when Naaman stands up, he's completely healed, and his flesh is completely healed. Leprosy's gone. But that's not the way Naaman had seen it. It's not the way he imagined this thing. And so when we go through the process and we get into the Spirit and the Word of God, we come back up and the flesh, because leprosy represents the flesh, represents the circumstance in the natural that needs to be changed, and it's not changing, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to be obedient to what God said. I'm going to get back down in that water a second time. I'm going to come back up out of that presence of God. And if that situation is still there, I'm doing the third time. Oh, I still have my addiction. I'm still struggling a little bit. I'm not going to quit. It's not over. Because 7 is God's perfect number. 7 is the completion. And I'm not going to quit until it's completed. I'm not going to quit trusting God. I'm not going to quit being obedient to God. I'm not going to quit running until the fullness is completed. And I see what it is God is calling me to believe for. I will not quit. Naaman went down 7 times on the 7th time, just like Elijah said. Our pride can keep us from winning our victories. And pride is anything that we hold more dear than obedience to the Word of God and the process that God is putting us through. But I guarantee you, when you trust God and you go through the process and you let Him have first place in your life, you come out a winner every time, no matter where you're at. I love this verse in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 6. It says, "For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness.'" In other words, the God that said, "Light be," and the world was created, has made that same light shine in your heart to give you the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. God has deposited inside of you the seed of His light, the same light that created the world lives in you. And the way that you come to understand and have knowledge of that and how it grows in you and that glory of God is seen in your life is when you are constantly in the face of Christ. Don't stop getting in the face of God. Don't stop pursuing the presence of God, because it's in that place where you experience the glory of God. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory." The first glory was the glory of the Old Testament. And in that glory, there was enough grace for God to say, if you do this, this, and this, you'll be considered righteous. But now through Christ, the new glory, the glory to glory, and the new glory, it is all based on Jesus Christ and what He did for us. And we are beholding like a mirror. When you see your face in a mirror, we are looking into the very glory of God. And this winning that happens in our life comes when we are tied in to our Savior Jesus Christ in a relationship that's real and pertinent and steadfast. How are we standing? I want to close with this thought. You know, I was watching a movie, and sometimes when you're watching movies, there's those one-liners that just kind of say, "Hey, that's cool. That's a really awesome quote." Well, I can't pronounce the name of the movie, but it's Queen of Katwe, I believe. It's a Disney movie. Sometimes Disney can be inspiring. And it's a movie about this young girl who lives basically in poverty. And she comes across this teacher who teaches her how to play chess. And because of her capacity to learn the game, she ends up becoming very wealthy and ends up coming out of her poverty. Now, in that process, of course, she plays other people who are very good at chess. At first, she finds it easy, but then she has some competitors that are a little bit more difficult. And there's this one game where she is sitting in front of the chess game in this match, and her opponent says, "Checkmate." Now, if you understand the game of chess, the idea is to essentially kill the king. It's to maneuver all these different pieces that can do different motions and different movements, and it can be complicated, so I won't explain it all. But the idea is to keep all your people to protect your king and kill the other person's king. And here she is, she's sitting in this competition, and her opponent says checkmate, which means that the next move, her king is dead. And without even thinking about it, she takes her king and she tips her king. She lays him down. And the coach is there. And he's just taken back because she had quit so easily. And he says to her, never, never tip your king too early. And a lot of us in our life, we quit because we don't know who our king is. And when we quit, we're tipping our king too early. We're saying our king doesn't have another move. We're saying our king doesn't have a way out. You serve a king that always has a way. You serve the way maker. You serve a king that no matter what your situation is, he can save you. He can bring you out. So never tip your king too early. Because when you give up, it's like saying God can't. And God is always saying, I can. I can. Let's stand. There is an enemy that wants to undermine your king. The devil is coming after you because he wants to make a show of your king. And God is saying, if you will just connect with me and realize who I am, you'll never ever give confidence to the enemy. And I want to encourage each and every one of you today to never give up. Whatever it is in your heart where you feel tired and weary and you want to give up, I'm telling you this morning by the grace of God to take courage and to don't give in. Don't give in.
Thank you for taking time to listen to today's message. If you are encouraged or challenged by what you heard today, please let us know. We'd love to hear from you. Send us your story to mystory@jubileecalgary.com. You can also invest in the lives of others by partnering with us financially. Your gift can impact many as God works through your generosity to help us continue sharing this message with others. Donations can be given online at jubileecalgary.com/give. Your feedback and giving are truly appreciated.